I was very ill. I was trembling continuously, even though it was August. It was very hot outside, and the sun was burning my skin at roll call. I was still trembling. I knew I had a very high fever. Both of my arms and legs were swollen and extremely painful. And I had all kinds of red patches throughout my body. So this second visit to the blood lab, they did not tie my arms. Instead of that, they measured my fever. And they found out that I had a very high fever and I was in trouble. I was taken to the hospital, which was another barrack, but it was filled this time with people who looked more dead than alive. I was placed in a small room with two twins who had chicken pox, and they told me that in this hospital we don't receive any food, no water, no medicine, that indeed people were broken to die. Next morning, Dr. Mengele came in with four other doctors, and those four doctors and Mengele saw me for the next 5 weeks twice a day. He looked at my fever chart and he declared, laughing sarcastically, he said, "Too bad, she's so young. She has only 2 weeks to live." I knew he was right, but I refused to die. I made a second silent pledge that I will prove Dr. Mengele wrong, I will survive and be reunited with my sister and the other twins. For the following 2 weeks, I have only one clear memory. I remember often waking up on the barrack floor. I was crawling because I no longer could walk. And I was crawling because I found out that there was a faucet with water at the other end of the barrack. And as I was crawling, I would fade in and out of consciousness. And in a semi-conscious state of mind, I kept telling myself, "I must survive. I must survive." After 2 weeks, my fever broke, and I immediately felt a lot stronger and better. It took me another 3 weeks before the fever chart showed normal, and amazingly, I was released and reunited with my twin sister and the other friends. But the happiness of our reunion was short-lived. Miriam looked very sick, and I asked her, "What have they done to you? What happened to you?" She said, "I cannot talk about it, and I will not talk about it," and we did not talk about it until 1985. It's an interesting thing. I believe that children who survive life and death cannot talk about it until two things happen. Number one, they feel physically strong enough to talk about it, and second, emotional healing takes a lot longer. Most survivors of tragedies are afraid that they are going to fall apart, and obviously that a defense mechanism. So when I talked to her in 1985, I asked her, "Miriam, do you remember when I was taken to the hospital?" And she said, "Yes." I said, "But what happened to you while I was in the hospital?" She said, "Well, for the first 2 weeks after you were taken away, I was kept in isolation with Nazi doctors monitoring me 24 hours a day, and they were waiting for something to happen. I don't know what that was. Of course, they never told me, and I don't know if it happened or it didn't happen. It was the same 2 weeks that Mengele said I would die. So I said to Miriam, it didn't happen. I spoiled the experiment. I survived because I was supposed to die. Would I have died?" And I found that out from some books. There aren't a lot of books about Mengele's experiment. There is one book, Dr. Nisri's book, and Dr. Eyewitness Account in Auschwitz, that said that most of the twins who died, and there were 1,500 sets of twins used in the experiment, they would inject a twin with a germ or a disease. When that twin died, they would kill the other one immediately, as close as the two twins, The subject and the control would die within minutes proximity, and then they would do the comparative autopsies.